Please feel free to read along with me, page 189 in the New Testament portion of the Bible. Now, before faith came, he was imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore, the law is a disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to a disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. May the Spirit of wisdom guide our understanding of this scripture.
Change clothes, and after it's all over, I guess it just out to Sandy Point for a baptism service.
Right. I guess, and mostly I just want to know, does our church consider other forms of baptism invalid? For example, what about the infant who's really sick? It might not make it. Would Pastor Raymond re-baptize a dying child? What about a child who is really serious?
All very good questions. And you know what? I don't think I know the answers myself. If you don't mind, I believe I'm going to mention our conversation today to Pastor Rick. Yes, I'm going to Pastor Rick. He's always looking for something to preach about. Maybe he'd like to do a sermon on our disciples. I'd like to use it back.
Oh, okay, sure. Probably be helpful for anyone else like me who's still getting to know the way around.
Exactly. If you had a question, maybe others do too.
Great. Thanks so much.
Well, I just happened to overhear what you all were telling me about. So I'd like to respond by first introducing you to my old friend Louise Priester. Because, well, she was a great fan of baptism. She was also our across-the-street neighbor in Indianapolis. She was one of two or three very important matriarchs of the church we served there. She worked in the attendance office at the local high school. And just a few weeks after I began my ministry, fresh out of seminary, she took me on a tour of the high school, introducing me to everyone, showing me all around. She would call out, "Hey Vivian, come here. I'd like you to meet our new little minister." Louise was a force to be reckoned with when she opened up her prayers by saying, "Our dear Heavenly Father, I'm pretty sure that God dropped everything to take the call." You know what? I was Louise Creaser's favorite little minister until, of course, I had the nerve to chew through my leash and disagree with her on the core values she held very dear. Louise believed that the only way a person was to be properly baptized was if that person was fully immersed, head to toe. My position was, and is, the more traditional belief of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ that an infant baptism with just a sprinkling of water was really probably just fine with God. Nope, she would say, gotta be dumped. Friendly disagreement came to a head when Louise's son, Tommy, had the audacity to marry a Presbyterian. And then had the audacity to have his brand new son baptized according to the Presbyterian practice of sprinkling, which is formally known, by the way, as aspersion. This drove Louise crazy. She used to come up to me after worship service and say, "Rick, I'm babysitting my grandson this Friday. How about you go ahead and fill the tub? I'll just bring you over his babysitter. His dad will never have to know." Well, we were never able to baptize that child according to Louise's heart's desire. But I imagine he's doing just fine without being immersed. There just seems to be something about baptism that people feel strongly about, and that people have felt strongly about for a long, long time, since Jesus' day, in fact. And so if you would allow it, in memory of my good friend and neighbor Louise Creaser, and with apologies to real historians in our midst, I'd like to lead you all on a very short history of baptism. We begin not with the first Christians, our discussion of baptism, but with Jewish traditions, out of which Christianity was born. For centuries, Jews have offered the rite of tefillah. Is that, am I saying that right? Tefillah? which is a cleansing ritual used in a variety of settings, and which is required of those who were not born Jewish, but wanted to convert to Judaism. The cleansing, or tevilah, happens in what is called a mikvah, or a pool of running water. It is likely that this practice was commonly known by the followers of John the Baptist, most of whom were Jewish. So that when John called for his people to repent way back in the first century and prepare themselves for the coming of the Messiah, it would make perfect sense for him to baptize his people in the River Jordan. Baptism was to John what an altar call might be for a modern-day evangelical preacher. If you really believe, then come forward, become pure. Well, one fine first century day, Jesus did just that. He came forward to be baptized by John in the River Jordan. John protested by saying, "It's you who should baptize me." Jesus insisted, and from all we know, Jesus was baptized by being immersed in the waters of the Jordan River. And we don't really know if Jesus ever baptized anyone. There's not actually much in the Gospels about Jesus and baptism. But if we fast forward to the book of Acts, after the resurrection, we can read about his followers using the rite of baptism as the primary way of becoming a follower of Jesus, a disciple. By that time, the rite of baptism included the image of the resurrected Christ. Then by the time the third century rolls around, baptism was seen less as an act of conversion and more as a necessity, if you will, for salvation. So that once Christianity, over time, they began the practice of baptism earlier and earlier until they began baptizing infants as soon after their birth as possible to ensure their salvation before anything could happen to them. These were times when often infants did not live very long. As time goes on, the rite of infant baptism becomes very formalized. Theologically, it was a rite that would make sure the child would inherit eternal life. Socially, it provided an official way to celebrate the child's birth, have a party. And legally, at least for a while, baptism named godparents who would agree to raise the child should that become necessary. And since the church was baptizing infants, it made much more sense to baptize them by sprinkling them with water than by immersing them. Fast forward several centuries through Christendom to the Reformation, whose 500th anniversary, by the way, we are celebrating this year. Happened in the year 1517. One of the groups that left the Catholic Church during the Reformation, in addition to the Lutherans and the Calvinists, were a group called the Anabaptists. Anna meaning re-Baptists. And they believed that a spoken, intentional confession of faith was an essential part of being baptized. So at great risk to themselves, some were actually tortured, even killed, because they were willing to do this. They would re-baptize people who had been baptized. In much the same way Louise Creasy was hoping to do for her grandson. Eventually, the Anabaptists migrated to the New World. They became Mennonites, Brethren, and Amish. While our tradition, Christian Church Disciples of Christ, does not come directly out of the Anabaptist tradition, our founders were very taken by this notion of believers' baptism. And so it is true that the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, believes that a baptism shouldn't happen until a child reaches what we would call the age of accountability, the age of being able to make a choice. And since we were founded out of an eagerness to do church in ways that resemble the New Testament, we baptize people the way Jesus, we think, was baptized, and the way his early followers baptized people, by immersing them fully in the waters, buried in the dead, raised to new life. Now, having said all of that, having said immersion is our preferred way to baptize people, we need to be put to act this. During the 1950s, there was a organized in what's called the ecumenical movement. The Christian Church Disciples of Christ became very interested in cooperating with other denominations, Lutherans, Episcopalians, Methodists, and sharing the love of Jesus Christ. And so it happened during the late 50s and early 60s that our denomination, Christian Church Disciples of Christ, made it part of our doctrine that while our practice would still be believers' baptism by immersion, we would fully recognize the baptisms of those who are baptized in a different way, and would not require anyone ever to be rebaptized just to be a member of the church. And so my guess is that today, in this room, we have some folks who were baptized as infants. And I guess in this room we have other folks who were dedicated as infants in front of this congregation or another one, and then immersed on or after the age of accountability. And we probably have some folks who've never been baptized. For you, the invitation is open no matter how old you happen to be. But because we recognize that God's Spirit is at work in so many ways that are beyond our understanding, and because we all arrive here from so many different places in life, we will never insist that anyone be baptized by immersion or sprinkling in order to be part of this fellowship. Who are we, after all, to judge how God works in people's lives? And the last thing we would ever want would be for someone to be turned away from the grace of God simply because of the particular way we practice even something as important as baptism. So, that's the deal on baptism. The Christian Church Disciples of Christ recognizes the importance of dedicating infants and their parents soon after the child is born. The ceremony draws the family into the care of the congregation. Usually it happens here. You all may have seen one of those. But it could happen elsewhere. It could happen in a hospital room. It could happen next door to an operating room. It could happen in a way that, in any way, that would bring the parents of such a child comfort. The Christian Church Disciples of Christ practices the rite of immersing people, young and not so young, but after they've become old enough to make a decision to follow Jesus, and after they're old enough to remember the day they were baptized. For the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, our baptism is more about giving us a real symbol of God's forgiveness than it is about securing our eternal salvation for the next world. And the Christian Church Disciples of Christ will never insist that someone be rebaptized in order to be a member here. Having said that, the baptismal tub, the one right here behind me, will be full of warm, running water on Sunday, June 4th, Pentecost Sunday. And so anyone who is so inclined is invited to make their confession of faith and enter into those waters. It would make for a beautiful day. It would be a great experience for all of us to see. And I'm here to tell you, it would make old Louise Priestley very, very